Welcome. This is Conversations with Matthew Bronson here on KUPR 99.9 FM in the high desert of Placitas, New Mexico. And you may also want to watch the video version of this on abqlive.tv. Either way, we're going to have a good time today. We're going to talk about something a little more heady than we normally do, and than I normally do. But all of us who are listening or viewing, I think it's safe to say there's some aspect of our life we want to change or improve. So that's our goal today, is to help give you another tool to make our lives better. And maybe I don't want to give it all away, but it's possible that maybe if I do something in my life to change, that will make people's lives around me better. Can't all be selfish.
Absolutely.
So we are welcoming Stan Alexander to the program, into Placitas from way down south in Albuquerque.
Thanks, Matt.
You found the way out here.
Yes, I did.
The internet is the source of all information, and some of it's actually correct. On stanalexander.com, I was reading about yourself, and you have been here since for like 30 years?
At this point, yeah, I guess about 30 years.
It mentioned that you had gone to grad school, but it didn't say where or what.
The University of Texas, El Paso.
Okay. And a particular course of study?
In grad school, it was a master's in educational psychology in counseling.
Okay. So that sounds like an employable degree.
Yes, it has been.
Because there are a lot of people who we run into all across the country get these degrees, and about the only thing you can do with it is, it's like Amway. You can just have more kids come to school so you can teach them. There's not a particularly good use for it. Right, so you are also a master practitioner of NLP, which is neuro-linguistic programming through the National Federation of Neuro-Linguistic Psychology, a clinical hypnotherapist, certified life coach. How's that different than, like, my mother telling me what to do?
Actually, your mother telling you what to do is life coaching. However, at the same time, we're more trying to go ahead and get you to decide where you're going, as opposed to telling you what you should be doing or telling you where to go. That didn't sound good, did it?
No. Well, she would give me her desires of behavior, and then I would tell her where to go.
Right.
Okay. American University of NLP, is that... have anything to do with American University in Washington, D.C.?
No, it doesn't.
Okay.
No, totally separate. And they've actually changed the name now to American Union of Neurolinguistic Programming.
I'm assuming that was necessary.
I'm assuming it was necessary. Okay. That's my guess.
Then a life coach, as well as, we already talked about the hypnotherapy. That's a lot of stuff. How long does it take to acquire that education?
Well, the undergraduate in experimental psychology is 4 years, or slightly longer for most people nowadays.
Right.
Grad school, 2 more years. So you're looking at 6 there, which I think is really the foundation. It's one of my pet peeves, so to speak, individuals that just do NLP or just do hypnotherapy without the background in psychology, that don't have the professional training from university in mental health.
Right.
And are doing mental health. So in the long run, the core of it was about, for me, 6 years. Following that, went on, and I happen to have lucked out that in grad school, one of my professors was closely associated with some of the students of Milton H. Erickson. We'll get into a little bit later on. As a result, I ended up being trained a lot in NLP, Ericksonian hypnotherapy, in grad school. Then after that, NLP takes a few months of training.
If you have the other background.
Actually, it takes a few months of training even without it. Some programs are as short as several weekends. Most people taking it that way are really using it more for self-improvement and self-help, as opposed to using it to go out and actually do therapy.
All right. But you can get a business license with just the weekend classes.
Actually, yes, you could.
Okay.
At least in the state of New Mexico, there is no regulation of hypnotherapy, and there's no regulation of NLP.
Not even completing an online class or something. I've read a book or two on hypnotherapy, self-hypnosis, guided meditation. Even if I hadn't done that, I could go down and get a business license and practice as a hypnotherapist?
I know some people would be highly offended by me saying this, but unfortunately, yes.
Okay. Well, it's the old, it is what it is.
It is what it is.
So that would be an important point, not that we're beating up on people who practice.
Oh, no, not at all.
But if you are a potential customer, ask the credentials.
As the credentials, there are some individuals. Now, the organization that I am certified for hypnotherapy through, American Council of Hypnotist Examiners, does require a minimum of 250 hours of training. However, there are organizations that are out there where a person could go through a home study course, never talk to anybody directly, and still hang out a shingle and practice.
Is that the kind of thing that you might go through that kind of education versus the very intense one you had, but they may just be really good at it.
And some of them are.
Okay.
There are some individuals that are excellent. I can think of a few people that I've met that have only gone through a hypnotherapy training program.
Sure.
Or an NLP training program. And are very good at what they do, that are naturals.
But I wouldn't want, I don't know if it's comparable, because I, at least in my mind, I'm notorious for bad analogies. But if I'm going to an oral surgeon who went to dental oral surgery school but never went to dental school, he just did that last part.
Right.
I'm going to have a little less faith in him or her.
Understood.
And we found, in our family, as far as dentists, for some reason, if they went to University of Michigan Dental School, they were fantastic dentists.
Some schools are better than others.
Yeah. Or maybe we just
for
got
anything.
Lucky. Yes.
For anything.
Except Albuquerque Prep. That's the best for everything. So you were little Stan Alexander, and you go, I want to help people with their problems. Or were you going to be a cowboy or a rock star?
No, actually, to start with, my mother was pushing me and saying, you need to be a doctor.
A doctor?
A doctor, yes.
Any kind?
Any kind, as long as I can say my son the doctor.
Okay.
It was all good.
And it had anything to do with growing up in the Jersey City area of the country?
Oh, I am sure that some of it may have been cultural.
Okay. And did you go along with that, or at least pretend for a while?
In the beginning, my intent was to go ahead and major in psych, minor in biology, go on for psychiatry.
So you were doing both the science and the psychology at a young age.
Yes.
You weren't like, I'm going to be a chemist or something, or I'm
precisely.
Did you play music at all?
Yeah, I did clarinet, which I was really good at disturbing every dog in the neighborhood.
Excellent.
I was great at that.
I was happy when I was recovering from some medical stuff, only like 5-6 years ago, we had a 3 or 4 year old wire hair fox terrier. And I did not necessarily realize I was getting any better, but the dog stopped singing along. So I figured I had gotten better. Or maybe he got tired of singing the same song over and over
again. That could be.
I never asked him.
Yeah, and then went on to guitar and blues harp.
Harp?
Harmonica.
Oh, okay.
10-hole diatonic.
I'm thinking of the Amy Grant kind of Zephyr thing. Yeah, harmonica. I guess that's a musical instrument.
Oh, yes.
Maybe it's because so few people play it really well.
There are some individuals, including ones local to here, that are amazing.
Huh. Want to drop any names?
I couldn't tell you his last name, Vicente.
That's probably enough.
A gentleman in the blues community in Albuquerque, which I'm not part of, but I have a good friend there who performs regularly, and have heard him a number of times. The man is amazing.
He's not a solo act?
No.
Okay.
No.
I don't think I could do, would be like Zamfir or something.
No.
So, did you ever, in your educational path, kind of waver and go, this is not working out the way I want, or you set the course and that was it?
No, wasn't it? Because partway through I decided, I'm not as interested in doing med school. Med school is going to basically tell me, and this is what most psychiatrists do, they do 15-minute sessions, many of them, not all of them. There are some excellent ones. But there are some out there that do a 15-minute session every 6 months. The session is comprised very often of, how are you doing? How are your meds working? What meds do we need to adjust?
This could be more of everything.
I will see you in 6 months.
Wow.
I don't believe that that's enough. While I do believe that biochemistry plays a major role in our emotions, I don't believe that simply going ahead and medicating people is enough. There's a lot more to it. And of course, the question then comes up of, do environmental situations create the biochemical changes in the brain? Or do the changes with the biochemistry in the brain create the emotional state?
Right.
And we don't have a really good answer yet.
Yet, meaning we're on the brink of it?
Well, there's research that's being done. You get the individual that is depressed. We know at this point that degree and speed of the uptake of serotonin in the system
right.
does play a role, is a major role in it. Well, does depression create a change in the reuptake of serotonin? Or does the speed of reuptake of serotonin produce the depression? It's which came first, the chicken or the egg?
The rooster.
Actually, I think so.
Oh, yeah. So environmental, so could it be I'm gluten intolerant, and so that is somehow affecting all my other endocrinic systems?
Could be, I don't know.
Well, I don't mean me personally, but yeah. but as a practicing NLP therapist and all the other things you don't draw blood and send it out for analysis.
No.
So how do you know if it's environmental?
We assume that the cause of a lot of things is, how do we code things in our mind? How do we code things in our brain? We have to code everything. If you think about this, you would not know the difference between yesterday, today, and tomorrow if you didn't code time.
Well, I got to tell you, at this stage of the game, Stan, I'll often ask my wife, is it Tuesday or Wednesday? So I don't know if I'm depressed or if I just don't have any specific place to be.
You know, though, if something took place a short while ago or something took place a long time ago.
Yes.
You code that somehow internally.
Okay.
Some individuals will take, to give you one quick example, somebody might take a situation from the past, but their coding of it is in the present.
All right.
As a result, they constantly are focusing upon that and reliving it. This is basically getting into a subcategory of NLP, which some people look at as a separate area totally, dealing with timeline therapy.
So is that kind of when people will say, stop living in the past?
Yes.
It's done, move on?
We do it all the time if you think about this. We will regularly, even in our motions, we might say something along the lines of, well, back when I used to, and we'll motion behind us.
Right.
That tells you where that person's timeline is. Other people may look at you and say, well, I remember back then.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Well, you're pointing to your left now instead of behind you.
So. Exactly. Some will do more of a classic timeline, like they did in a history class.
Right.
Where it went from left to right. Other individuals, you'll see, it'll go from behind to forward. Some, it will go from out here, coming in, and then the future out here. People tend to form the timeline in all different ways. So the only reason I got into that at all is we code things internally. Another way of thinking about it with coding is, let's say that, and actually your listeners could do this right now, if you're to be thinking about something that is troubling to you, if you were to go ahead, close your eyes, and imagine that big, bright, colorful, three-dimensional, associated, in other words, as if you were in that situation right at this very moment, being able to see, hear, feel everything as if that situation were happening right at this moment. And now if you clear that thought, And instead what you do is you imagine whatever that same image, whatever that same thought is, in black and white. And this time, shrink the size down, step out of it as if it is just a small postage stamp, black and white image of that same thing. Turn down the volume. Turn down the brightness. Turn down the clarity. If it were three-dimensional before, make it two-dimensional. And notice the difference in how you respond to it. For almost everybody, and obviously we're doing that much quicker than we would normally do it
right.
in a clinical setting, the individuals are going to almost always find that when you take that image and you shrink it down, you change its coding of it.
Right.
You change, think of it this way, you're changing the cinematic qualities.
Right. Basic cable versus 4K Ultra.
Yeah, or the way I've described it, similar to some individuals, is why are we more impacted going to a Dynamax type theater?
Right.
Or IMAX theater, I should say.
Sure.
We're impacted greater by this large image that is surrounding us, that we feel immersed into, with a surround sound system going, as opposed to if you watch that same film in black and white on a small screen.
Oh, yeah.
Does that make sense?
Oh, you get to those 16-plex movie theaters. Mm-hmm. My TV at home is bigger.
Right. And absolutely.
When I was, before high school, I grew up in the suburbs of Washington, D.C., and right into the district was an old, original movie theater.
Mm-hmm.
But it was the surround.
Yep.
I don't know how big this screen was,
mm-hmm.
but it like wrapped around the whole front of the theater,
mm-hmm.
and we went to see How the West Was Won.
Mm-hmm.
And I just remember having to pan my head from left to right, even though
yes.
we were back enough, because the screen was just so ginormous.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, obviously it was a classic great movie,
yes.
but I wonder how much more it has stayed with me having seen it in that environment.
Exactly. So now when you think about us coding things internally that way.
Right.
If that person, if a client, for example, has a fear of snakes, and they are imagining snakes big and large right in front of them.
Right.
As opposed to seeing this little black and white image that's way off in the distance. Which is going to get your heart beating faster? If you love snakes or hate snakes, doesn't matter.
Right. The big, colorful ones that are close to me.
Exactly. So when we start, we're looking at how does the person code things in their own mind? And also, NLP is extremely complex. There is so much to it that we could talk probably for hours about it.
Right.
Also, what is the self-talk? What language? It's neuro-linguistic programming.
Correct.
What linguistic impact is coming through from a person's words? Now, we see this in society all over the place anyhow.
Well,
advertising,
certainly.
Politicians, every place.
Well, that is an area I would like to go into a little bit. Once I ask you this other
sure,
question.
Sure, absolutely. Go for it.
And this is still KUPR 99.9 FM here in Placitas, New Mexico. We're speaking with Stan Alexander. We are going to lump you all together and say Master Practitioner of Neuro-Linguistic Programming and Clinical Hypnotherapist. Is that enough?
That's perfect.
It's 80%.
That's perfect.
I've always been a good solid B student. You know, 15 minutes into it here, let's give me a definition. What do you do for a living, Stan?
What I do for a living is help individuals change the way that they are thinking. I don't change it for them. I help them change the way that they are thinking that they can achieve the outcomes in their life that they desire most.
And, well, you know, I'm pausing because I'm thinking, wouldn't most people just say, I want to be happier.
And if you said that you want to be happier,
right.
then we're going to start looking at what in NLP we call well-formed outcomes.
Well-formed outcomes. Okay. The souffle doesn't drop.
That's one way of looking at it.
Okay. You can tell I like to cook.
Yes, I can. And I like to eat.
There you go.
So,
a marriage made in heaven.
I know. What can I tell you? Think about it this way. There's one thing we call an as-if frame. Okay. An as-if frame basically means, what would your life be like if you could imagine as if you already had that happiness? What would be different stated in the positive? In other words, not, well, I wouldn't stay in bed all day. Although some people that might be happiness.
It depends who else is there.
Depends who you're talking to, exactly. It might be a person saying to you, I would, if I were happier, I would go out and develop more friendships. If I were happier, I would get involved in a certain activity or sport.
Right.
Or other things might be, if I were happier, I would go back to school.
So the happiness is a symptom as opposed to a condition.
In a way, yes. What we're looking for are positive actions. We're looking for, what are those behaviors? Empirical, measurable.
Mm-hmm.
Not just, I'd be happier. What's happiness? It varies from person to person.
Absolutely, but if I'm considering seeking out some assistance, and mm-hmm. I'm considering NLP, neuro-linguistic programming, because I recognize I'm not as happy as I think I could be or
yes.
used to be, or maybe people around me, and maybe they're just pretending more or drink earlier in the day. I don't mm-hmm. know what. But and it's not as if people don't think about it, but I can't say, well, I would join more groups, or I'd spend mm-hmm. more time painting. I don't know what I would do if I were happier. I mm-hmm. just want to be happier.
Right. And then that's where it starts becoming my job to ask those questions as to how you would know.
But am I honest with myself? How do I know? Maybe I'm depressed and I'm fooling myself.
You may be.
But you can tell that.
You can tell that.
Okay.
You're going to be able to tell that. And
right.
sometimes it takes a couple of sessions, a couple of hours, to be able to get a person to come to, what would have to take place? What evidence would you need to have in your life to know that you are happier? Because happiness does vary from person to person to such a degree.
Oh, yes.
It's one of those that it means a million different things.
Sure. So it sounds like an NLP session or series of sessions is quite different from going to a psychologist where they don't really give you too much. You're doing much more leading questions
mm-hmm.
to allow discovery.
Right, and it depends on the school of psychology, to be fair. You know, because
right.
you do get people in cognitive behavioral psychology, which NLP is very close to, where they will be trying to get you to connect. We talk very often about getting a person to connect from the surface structure to the deep structure of their communication. This goes back to an outdated model of linguistics called transformational linguistics. And that has nothing to do with psychology. It has to do with how do we communicate? How do we deal with language? Because we all need to distort, delete, and generalize. If you think about happiness,
right.
in what in NLP is called the meta model, which is part of transformational linguistics, happiness is what's called a nominalization. A nominalization is a word such as love, happiness, peace. Think about it this way. If we use it as a noun in a sentence,
right.
but we can't put it physically into a wheelbarrow, it's a nominalization. It actually is a process. Anger. The person says, I am angry.
Right.
Well, they are not angry. Anger is a process that a person is going through. When the person is able to comprehend that this is a process, without saying to them, because look, if I simply say to you, you're expressing that you are angry.
Right.
That's a process. It's not a constant state.
Correct.
You might get that on a cognitive level. That might make perfect sense to you intellectually.
Right.
Does that help you?
No.
No.
And am I angry at me, or am I angry at you, or am I angry at the government or traffic? I don't know.
When the person's able to get to that point, though, of being able to say, what I am experiencing at this moment is the emotion that I call anger.
Right.
The realization that this is transitory, in and of itself, says to the unconscious, this is not who I am, this is not what I am. This is something I'm experiencing at the moment that is going to pass. It is going to change. That produces a change in and of itself.
Right.
That can take a while for the person to get to, obviously.
But that situation may change because your life will end, and that's the only way
that's
that
a possibility.
Unhappy. And it, you know, I don't know why we started with happiness. I guess I did, but it's or anger, and I may be well more adjusted than everybody who knows me mm-hmm. thinks I am. But I've always looked at anger as you didn't make me angry.
Correct.
I allowed your behavior
exactly.
to make me angry.
Exactly. Absolutely.
So if I don't give you that power, then I'm not going to get angry.
Which goes into another part of NLP, which is an extremely important part, which is learning to control your own state, which is exactly what you're talking about there.
Right.
Being able to access a desired state. So if you were feeling angry at the moment.
Right.
If you're able to re-elicit a previous state of happiness, whatever that might mean, whoops, sorry about that.
That's okay.
Whatever that might mean for you.
Right.
And you're able to re-elicit that state.
But what you're talking about, Stan, is a process.
Correct.
There is a certain amount of time. It may only be 2 or 3 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
But let's say we're driving together. We commute
right.
all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You do not use your turn signals at all.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a hot button for me. So we're coming up to a light, and you're going to make a turn, and you don't put it on. And I snap and go, you know, GD, Stan, use your turn signal. It's a reaction.
Yes.
How do I teach myself to count to 10? You know, isn't anger a trigger? How do you de-trigger it?
The anger isn't the trigger. The turn signal was the trigger.
Okay, so it is your fault. No.
Yes, it's all my fault. Ask my wife.
Yes.
She'll tell you.
Anybody's fault.
I know, what can I say? So the turn signal is the trigger there that elicits for you
mm-hmm.
the state of anger at that moment. Well, that's something that, I know we're going into so many areas of NLP all at once, but there. That is what we call.
I'm a non-linear thinker.
That's what we call an anchor.
Okay.
So an anchor, the easiest way of describing an anchor, if you can think of a song that brings up a certain emotion.
Yes.
A lot of us can. It makes us think of that first kiss.
Barry White.
Right, exactly. Or you heard a song that was playing when something horrible took place. And now every time you hear it, it makes you go back to that moment. That's an anchor.
Okay.
Not anger. Anchor.
Anchor. Yes.
Like on a boat.
Nautical.
Yes. So, for some people call it a trigger. In NLP, we talk about it as an anchor.
Okay.
The turn signal thing becomes the anchor for producing the anger.
Yes.
One thing takes place, and if we really want to go back to traditional psychology, we can go back to behavioral psychology and be saying, if we have, because a signal in a car is not an unconditioned response.
Correct.
Right? So we can be saying, either through operant or classical conditioning, if we want to go back to traditional psychology.
To the Dr. Philip Zimbardo world?
Or B.F. Skinner.
Okay.
We can be looking at it and saying, this takes place, Pavlov. Brings the bell, the animal salivates.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. So I've heard.
The person doesn't click their directional on.
Right.
You froth at the mouth.
A slight exaggeration,
you know,
but yeah.
You understand
what I'm saying.
Yeah. So you get that association that's going. The trick there is to collapse that anchor. So that when the person does that, you may still have a degree of annoyance. I know I do. It's one of my pet peeves also.
Okay.
And I swear I've seen it more here than I've seen it in many other states. The not signaling thing.
Yeah.
I'm not sure exactly why.
But can't you...
But...
I just don't know how I deprogram myself because it happens so quickly. I can afterwards go, oh, I shouldn't have blown up or something. And I don't blow up at turn signals. I'm just using this as an example of how do we recondition ourselves when things are so knee-jerk. We end up doing more... If we recognize the problem, we'll probably apologize. I'm not sure how to get to the point to do the behavior modification to not have it happen.
Right, and that's where it really does have to be customized to each individual client. Mm. However, let's say that the person... Let's say that you were pairing up using the directional again.
Yes.
Let's say that you were able to pair in a suggestible state using hypnotherapy.
Right.
Let's say that you could pair seeing somebody not signal with a state of peace and a state of calmness. That now, after you work with it, that action or lack of action of not turning on the directional, you find actually relaxes you.
Okay.
Now, I wouldn't recommend going about it quite that way because personally I think people should be using them.
Certainly.
However, if that no longer has that same impact on you, if it's paired now with something that is more positive, or another technique that we may use with it is we may have the person elicit that state of anger at that moment.
Right.
We may then go ahead and do some submodality changes, like what we were talking about before, changing cinematic qualities.
Yes.
Step out of it. Make it two-dimensional. Turn it to black and white. Now, having the person imagine going through the situation again. So now, let's say they imagine themselves driving with somebody, just like you were talking about.
Right.
The individual doesn't signal. Being able to practice and rehearse internally. If you wanted something that you could do on your own, for
right.
example.
Okay.
Rather than something that I'd be sitting there saying, let me guide you through after interviewing you and figuring out what is the most efficient technique for you. A person could, and this is something I recommend to people all the time, is think what took place during the day that you wish you may have responded to better.
Right.
So in this case, you're driving with this person, they don't signal, and for just a moment there, that anger comes up.
Correct.
So what I'll have the person do is get into a relaxed state, which is basically a form of self-hypnosis, which all hypnosis is self-hypnosis in the long run.
I understand.
I'll have them run through three alternative ways they could have behaved. I'll have them make one of those humorous.
Mm-hmm.
So, that might be, I don't know, what might be a humorous thing that would pop in your head as an alternative to being angry?
Anything humorous?
Sure. That you might have done in that situation. You don't have to do any of these things.
Okay. But when someone says what's humorous, I think of Ashton Kutcher on his old show, 2.5 Men or whatever.
Okay.
He always said, nothing is funnier than midgets and monkeys.
Okay.
Which is probably insulting to many groups, but that's what he said. So that's just something humorous.
Okay, so how would you apply that to somebody not signaling?
I guess I would think about midgets and monkeys.
Okay, let's take that a little bit further then.
Okay.
So instead of just thinking about midgets and monkeys, how would you apply midgets and monkeys to your response? So that might be, for example, that in the future, that what you do is you have a monkey hand puppet.
Yes.
And every time the person does not signal,
cool.
you reach out the window and you signal to all the other drivers with a monkey sock puppet.
Okay.
Okay, now that's more humorous, right?
Yes.
But we got a monkey.
And more
right?
politically correct.
Yes, we're not going to.
So I have to carry a sock puppet with me?
Well, that would be your humorous example. You don't have to do any of these. So now let's say that we took two other alternatives that did not involve anger.
Okay.
That you might actually use.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say that one of those, for example, was that you said calmly to the individual, I really would appreciate if you would signal, it just makes me feel safer.
Okay, but probably I've said it for five years.
You may have. Yeah. This is just an example yeah. of one approach.
Sure. But what I'm thinking of is turn signals not
No, it isn't.
Changing.
I'm only using that because you mentioned that one.
And I don't know what I'm doing.
Overthinker. But road rage is
yes.
very important.
Mm-hmm.
And the person not signaling, I don't think it's as minor as you're saying. Because after all, situations have taken place where somebody has hit somebody.
Right.
Pulled out a weapon.
Mm-hmm.
Because somebody didn't put on their directional.
Or did something really...
So what the example you gave is not a bad example.
Whew, that was close.
So now if that individual is able to... And like I said, this is something I recommend people do daily.
Right.
Thinking to themselves, what is something that took place during the day that I would like to be able to do differently? Or I'd like to respond to differently?
And wouldn't they be bigger things like, I shouldn't have had that other piece of pie, or I shouldn't have eaten the last of the ice cream if I'm going to involve other people?
It could.
Those seem more, or, you know, I shouldn't be smoking cigarettes. Those are big things. Mm-hmm. And not that not using your turn signal is not reckless driving and inconsiderate and dangerous, but it's not, I don't know if I would seek out the assistance of a professional to help me get over my anger of turn signals.
Unless you were somebody who, let's say, were arrested for road rage.
Okay.
Then you might be, and the court might order you getting some therapy for it.
So there is no small problem.
There is no... Something along those lines could turn into a lethal problem.
Right. Sure.
So I'm not belittling the example you gave at all. But to get back to the technique on it,
right,
you would be saying, okay, and this is, like I said, something for anything and everything. If you are there and you say, the way that I responded to my wife today, right, when she, and this actually happened.
<I'm> to there, somebody's wife.
Yeah, that happened to mine.
Okay.
I'm there shaving this morning.
Right. Yourself.
Myself.
Not the dog.
Not the dog.
Okay.
She comes in through the bathroom, mm-hmm, running through. Bump.
Ooh.
As a result, I'm a little bit high in this corner right here today.
You know, it's so funny you say that because I did notice it. Because right over your right lip, there is a slight...
Uh-huh.
And I just thought maybe that was your natural hairline.
No.
It was your wife.
That was my wife. It's all her. I'm telling mm-hmm you, see?
So what did you do? You stabbed her?
My response to it was, be careful, which is okay.
Yes.
But let's assume that my response to it was to absolutely snap and get nasty.
Sure. Verbally.
Verbally. Absolutely. So now I could run through this exercise of saying, let me pick out three alternatives, making one of them humorous.
Mm-hmm.
Let me imagine seeing all of those as if they were on a movie theater screen. Let's watch each of those. Do any of those, including the humorous one.
Right.
So what could I imagine that would be a humorous way of responding to that? So I decide I'm going to just shave off that entire side of the mustache.
I like it.
And the beard on the opposite side.
Okay. This would be like an old Star Trek.
I know.
Thing.
This is looking pretty good now,
yeah,
right? So I could put that in there as a humorous thing. Oh, better yet. As a humorous thing, as my response, I'm going to take the razor and I'm going to go vroom, like that, right down the middle of her head, and she gets a skunk stripe.
Cool.
This is what I mean by coming up with something that's humorous.
Right. And you think of these, you share these.
You just think of this. You go ahead, this is later.
Right.
This is for changing future behaviors. That behavior took place already. There's nothing more we can do about that moment.
Right.
But what can we do about the future? So if I'm there thinking of two alternatives that would be good alternatives. Here's one. Lock the door
yes
to the bathroom while I'm doing that.
Mm-hmm.
The mirror's right next to the door that I was using.
All right.
That could be one.
Right.
Let's say another one is to voice to her in advance, I'm getting ready to shave. If you come into the bathroom, please be careful. That could work.
Yes.
It could. And the third one is, if she does that again, skunk stripe.
Okay.
Okay. So now I run through all of these one at a time as if watching it in a movie theater.
Right.
I decide if any of those are ones I would like to adopt into my life for future ways of behaving. Then we go ahead, and I'm leaving out a few steps of this,
sure,
but then we go ahead and associate step into that example, run that movie back. Run it forward again in first-person perspective instead of third-person. Third-person, we're watching it on the screen. First-person, we're actually stepping into that character on the screen, that other you, and running through it again. Now, running through it again in a future scenario. So now I'm imagining that we are on vacation, and I'm getting ready to do something very similar.
Right.
So it's a different setting.
Trimming your goatee.
Right. Okay. Trimming the goatee. And applying that same new behavior to that situation. And I may run through two or three scenarios that would be similar, maybe not identical. Because probabilities are the identical thing isn't going to happen again.
Right. But Stan, this sounds like a very well-adjusted person thinking about it after the fact. My experience has been, at least for me, if I lash out or just get upset, then there's the apology period.
Okay.
And then I don't think about it again.
And the goal here is basically to program your mind so that your automatic response in the future is different than the response you had at that moment.
But isn't that's taking personal responsibility?
Absolutely.
Which we don't do. So
some do.
All right. Well, then all right, that
some do.
I did want to go back to what you had started to say before.
Sure.
Before you kind of gave the explanation of NLP, and you were saying, you know, different behavior in different groups.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, all over the world, even just in this country, there are so many social economic strata that mm-hmm. what is polite in one community mm-hmm. is insulting in another.
Absolutely.
And what happens if you are part of one group and want to deal with another group? Do you have to prepare in advance to, you know...
To a degree,
don't
yes.
Don't say this, don't say that.
There we're talking about basically cross-cultural behavior. And yes, if you do not know the customs of a different group, yes, you're going to have to prepare.
The reason I kind of picked up on what you were
Absolutely.
Saying was advertising.
Mm-hmm.
Big into subliminal messages, or I'm sure they have all kinds of NLP people and everybody else.
Probably.
I may have been affected by a radio or TV or commercial on my phone because it's showing me a product or a service that I'm mm-hmm. not aware of.
Right.
But I don't believe I have changed cornflakes or cars
mm-hmm.
or where I buy my gas from an ad. So who are they targeting? They wouldn't do it if it didn't work.
Exactly.
But I don't know, I can't think of anybody that is going to switch from Burger King to Wendy's because of that commercial.
But people do.
Do they really?
People do. That's why people get paid millions for advertising and for coming up with campaigns. People do make changes and look at it and go, they have convinced them,
mm-hmm.
they persuaded them. And NLP has been used quite a bit for persuasion.
Can you give me an example of some commercial or advert that you think was particularly NLP-ish?
Off the top of my head, probably not.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to think if I can.
I don't know if there were any
textbooks. I don't watch a whole heck of a lot of
TV,
to be honest with you. So I couldn't even
But you see
you
the paper, you see magazines.
Right.
There's no way to avoid being marketed to.
No, there's no way that you're going to avoid being marketed to. An example, though, without citing any specific
sure.
ad campaign, because I really can't think of one off the top of my head. Well, let's see. I can ask you one thing. That is an old ad campaign.
All right.
See if you can complete this for me. Winston tastes good like a...
Cigarette shit.
When's the last time you heard that?
Recently.
Okay.
Because I'm not a good sleeper,
mm-hmm.
and I have become fascinated with 1940s detective radio shows, or their old Gunsmoke,
mm-hmm.
and the Dragnets, and they keep the cigarette commercials in.
Okay.
Or the cereal commercials, post-toasties, heap big flavor, and for not much wampum. It's like, this is so politically incorrect.
When would you say the average person last heard that?
Oh, when did they stop advertising cigarettes? About 20 years? 70s,
I believe.
Okay, so 50
However,
years.
However, why did I just use that? I use that because 95 plus percent of individuals that are in your age range will be able to answer it just as quickly as I'd walk a mile for a...
For a camel?
A camel.
Yeah. Yeah, I know those commercials.
Yes.
And I can sing the McDonald's song probably, and Lucky Strike means fine tobacco or whatever all those were. But at one point, probably in the 70s, I was a tobacco smoker. And never switched brands because of any of those commercials.
No.
But
however, some people do.
Okay.
Some people are going to switch because of the commercial.
I mean, even when Jack Webb came on and go, you know, Chesterfield, they're my choice and they should be yours too. And a physician studied 100 smokers and no signs of throat irritation. It's like, really? Are you kidding me?
So, yeah, which we all know is false now.
So yeah, I mean, jingles and stuff, I know they work because they get
they
in your
work.
Head.
They get in your head. They have you thinking about that product. It does impact people. Otherwise, advertising wouldn't be the multi-billion dollar industry that it is.
I wonder, and the reason I say that is when my wife and I were working professionally for a Fortune 50 company and would do trade shows, and they were hundreds of thousands of dollars, you know, entrance fees, flying people around, the trade show equipment, the giveaways, the adult trick-or-treating, as I call it. And why were we there? Probably because everybody else was there. I don't know if I could point any direct sales as a result of us going halfway around the world for a week. I liked it. It was better than working. But I often wondered, God, that... And we just had layoffs, so that would have been five people you didn't have to fire if you didn't go.
Right.
I can't say that the advertising, they continue and spend $3 million a minute on the Super Bowl because it works. I think it just kind of has become, that's what you got to do.
Some of it is, that's what you've got to do. You've also got to keep the name out there in front of people.
Yes.
If you don't keep the, if you don't continue to work, and I realize we're kind of getting off of NLP at the moment, but branding.
Right.
You know, the branding becomes so important.
Sure. There's McDonald's and Coca-Cola all day long.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know.
All right. Well, then as far as NLP or hypnotherapy or us being happier, what are the top reasons people seek you out?
Relationship issues, behavioral changes such as smoking cessation, weight loss. Those are probably of the biggest things I deal with. And individuals that do feel like, I don't know where I'm going. I don't know where I even want to be going. And those are harder because you do have to ask the questions to get them to finally say, this is what I'm really wanting in my life. And even then, it changes.
Yes.
Nothing's written in stone. It's going to change.
Maybe I'm too much of a cynic, but I think it was probably early 80s. First really big, you know, romance breakup. And I knew that, at least what I'd heard, men don't do well with that. And they should probably kind of lay low for a year or so before they stick their toe back in the water.
Sure.
This was when we had even better insurance than we have now. And I remember talking to a sociologist. I said, that, you know, I think mental health and happiness is really for the wealthy or well-insured.
Unfortunately, that's actually very true.
But isn't it also the period of history? At one point, you know what made a good day? Is that an animal didn't eat me.
Yep.
And I'm satisfied. Yep. And I got something to eat. So isn't everything after that the kind of bonus? You know, I'm so unhappy. You know, my cousin isn't coming to my birthday party. and you mope around for a month, or my boss looked at me cross-eyed, or somebody else got the promotion.
Absolutely.
That's such trivial stuff.
A lot of it is. However, it's not to that individual. And you're right. There was a point that an animal didn't eat me today. It was a good day.
Yeah.
As we started to evolve as human beings, it became an animal didn't eat me and I found shelter.
Right.
But going back to Maslow's hierarchy there, of simply saying what are the basic needs, and at the very base of Maslow's hierarchy, we're talking about food, shelter, basic basics to live.
Right.
At the very top, we're talking self-actualization at the top of that pyramid.
How many people are up there?
Very, very few. I'm still trying to, you know, get past the third layer.
And so NLP and psychology and hypnotherapy can all help us get there.
They can help in getting there. They're not going to do it for you. It is a all of these things are tools for the person to use in helping themselves get as close to that level of self-actualization.
And what is self-actualization? I remember on the one of the Star Treks, they had that android Data.
Mm-hmm.
And because he was self-aware, the Federation made him a life form.
Yes.
So I'm already a life form. So how would I know that I'm self-actualized?
Have you accomplished all of those lower levels? Basically, are all parts of your life to the point that now you can be focusing upon your spiritual growth, be focusing upon altruism? Most of us never really, okay, personally, I'm not sure I believe altruism even exists.
Right.
Which I realize is a very cynical thing to say. However,
that's your observation.
Well, most individuals, there is a payoff for altruism.
Yes.
In which case, is it altruism?
I don't know.
Do you understand my point?
Right. Oh, yes.
Because on a lot of these things, I totally agree with a lot of what you're saying.
Well, isn't that also in some, I know a little bit about some of the recovery programs, and one of the psychological programs you go through is doing something for somebody and not letting them know that you did it.
That you did it.
That's a toughie.
It is, but don't you still feel good from it?
Right, so maybe there is.
Is there a payoff?
Yes, you feel better.
There might be a payoff. The individual that is saying, well, I do this because of my spiritual beliefs. Well, for some of those individuals, it's for a blessing from God, or a, you know, nicer mansion in heaven.
Right.
Or to come back as a better being if you believe in reincarnation. You know, there's always that payoff.
But does that negate the altruistic behavior?
It doesn't negate the benefits of the behavior.
Okay. It's like we started a family practice that someone else had suggested to us, folks who hang out by the, you know, the exits on the highway.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than giving them money, keep a few bottles of cold water in the car and give it to them.
Great idea.
They probably curse me when I pull away.
They may.
But I still feel better because it's hot out there.
Exactly. It still benefits you, and you're right, it benefits them. It does not negate the benefit of the action.
Right.
You know, it simply is a question I have in my mind of, does true altruism of doing with absolutely no payoff actually even exist? I'm not sure if it does or not.
But yeah, because people interpret the payoffs, you know, it could be that warm feeling inside.
Exactly.
Or it could be that extra $50,000 a year.
Or it could be that blessing that you might get.
Right.
Or the better karma.
Mm-hmm.
Or what have you. So when we're talking about that self-actualization part of the hierarchy, we're talking about the person that has achieved that level that obviously neither one of us have got to yet, because we don't comprehend it.
No.
So what can I tell you?
But maybe it is so elusive that you know, it's like vapor, you can't really grab it.
Right.
We could have it and we don't even know it. And the,
possible.
The folks that you see in all the TV shows and movies, you know, the monks with the, the Tibetans or whatever, I don't know. Are they happier? I wouldn't think that'd be...
I'm not sure.
That didn't seem like a nice life to me.
I wouldn't want it.
No.
It's not my first choice, obviously.
No, but they don't even have basic cable.
Exactly.
So, all right, well, what I'm trying to be able to have everybody accomplish through this conversation, if nothing else other than having a good time, is something that probably is not possible, right? We'll just say the, you know, the big things again. Mm-hmm. Eat better, sleep better, sure. Be kinder to your friends and mates, and mm-hmm. exercise more, and don't smoke, and drink in moderation, if at all. Mm-hmm. We all know this.
Absolutely.
Everything is at crisis level in this country and in most of the civilized world.
Yep, so, you're right.
Well, we're smart, but we're really stupid. Or mm-hmm. there's something in us that allows us to constantly, repeatedly, several times a day, make bad decisions.
Yes.
Fix me.
Unfortunately, it's not like a magic wand. That's actually one of the things I always try to make clear to people when it comes to hypnotherapy.
Right.
Or NLP. A lot of people come in and think it's going to be, look into my eyes, you sleep like a baby.
Right.
I wish it worked that way. I would charge a lot more if it did. That'd be great. Unfortunately, we haven't found the way to do that yet.
You're right.
There isn't one technique that works.
I don't know. Do babies sleep well? They seem to mess themselves and cry all night.
Yeah,
I don't want to sleep like a baby.
I don't know. You don't want to wake up in a puddle?
No.
Okay, just checking.
Right. Did I pass?
I mean, we could do some hypnosis and yes. help you with that.
I love hypnosis. Mm-hmm. I've done it throughout my whole life for various different things, and it's absolutely not like TV.
Not at all.
It is so different. Mm-hmm. I don't even know where the TV got it from.
A lot of bad books and movies have come out that, yes.
And guided meditation, mm-hmm. self-hypnosis, and I introduced that to my wife, and it's fantastic. It doesn't take a lot of effort.
And that's where people can start doing some things even on their own. That goes back to that exercise I was talking about of how could you have handled any situation better.
Right. But what I want to get over is, or through, on the other side of, tomorrow morning, mm-hmm. I'm going to do 5 minutes of stretching.
Okay.
If I do that 3 times a week, I'm going to feel so much better.
Okay.
Still not doing it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to have a smoothie instead of some eggs and toast.
Okay.
Still have eggs and
toast.
So
let's stick with just the one thing, the stretching.
Okay.
If we were talking about that, there are a few techniques that I'd be using professionally.
Right.
One of them is called the propulsion system. In NLP, what a propulsion system basically means is I'm going to have you doing the visualization, the guided imagery like you were talking about a moment ago.
Right.
Part of it, now of course this is after doing more clinical interview with you, would be finding out if you don't, what's the negative? I'm also going to be finding out if you do, what are the positives? What are the benefits of it? But I also want to know the negatives.
But don't we know that?
We know that. However, you know that consciously. Do you have that unconsciously? Unconsciously, your mind is still saying, I know, I don't want to. Think of it this way.
I'd rather buy bigger pants.
Right. See, now, I'm the opposite. I started off life, well, my adult life, being obese.
Not chubby.
No.
Obese.
Obese.
Okay. I was always chubby until I was 30.
You know, I was the kid that was there and was in the pretty large size pants and
the Sears Husky department?
Yeah, right, exactly. You got it. And
okay.
It wasn't, you know,
I've been there.
Little puppies.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then made those changes myself.
Sure.
Including the exercise.
Because of you or
mm-hmm.
because of a girl?
Because of me.
Okay. I'm more shallow.
However,
yes.
The girl helped.
All right. You're coming clean here.
It certainly helped.
All right.
You know, the idea of, well, if I keep myself more fit, of course. Now that's one of
But she liked you as an obese person. So what was the motivation to lose it?
Actually, she didn't even exist.
Oh, okay.
she wasn't even there at that point. Oh, there was one or two that were there. But,
right.
You know, mainly it was me looking at myself and saying, I need to make a change with this. So
was it quality or quantity of food?
Both.
Okay.
Both. And for most individuals, it's both. When I'm working with a person doing virtual gastric band, which is a technique that is amazing, for being able to take a person, create through hypnosis,
right.
an imaginary gastric band, one of my first questions is exactly that. Are we talking about portion, or are we talking about what you're eating, or both, or frequency of eating? All these things play a role.
Right.
So when the person is able to start If you're talking the exercise, you're talking stretching.
Right.
If
we're not talking about going to the gym. We're just talking about...
I hate gyms. I work out at home.
Yeah.
If you tell me every day you're supposed to go to the gym, I'm not going.
Right.
It's not happening for me.
Right.
Other people, that's different. I'd rather be doing it at home. So what I needed to be able to do was to say to myself, if I'm setting up that propulsion system, what are the positives? What are the negatives? Now when the person is in trance state,
yes,
then we can go ahead and we can say, okay, so now visualize, imagine, I'm not going to go through the whole thing, it would take quite a while to do this. Imagine not working out and having this negative outcome. And we're getting that into the unconscious. And I'll get into something with that in a moment to make that a little bit clearer.
Okay. But
now,
I should tell you, we need to wrap it up.
We'll wrap it up.
Okay.
Then what we need to be able to do is say, now when we take the positive, what is the payoff? Now, if we can get it that the person feels like, if I don't, I get this.
Right.
If I do, I get this great reward. The person's more likely to go ahead and actually start doing that stretching on a daily basis. The trick is the unconscious outpowers the conscious every time and has a little guard between them. Our job using trance and using NLP, using the linguistics, using a plethora of techniques, is to bypass that little guard, make the changes in the unconscious so the conscious mind and the unconscious mind are on the same page. When they're on the same page, they're going to work together. Otherwise, you've got this big unconscious that's going to always overpower the weaker conscious mind.
Right.
And as a result, people are going to find themselves fighting for a change that never takes place.
And hopefully this quote, or something similar to a quote that I'm going to mess up here, when I was trying to do some reading on NLP, they did get, someone was referencing conscious and subconscious, where the conscious mind makes the decision, but the subconscious mind makes it happen.
Yes, that would be a good way of putting it. Now, if you take smoking, I used to smoke. Years ago, I smoked. The conscious mind would say, "This is your last pack. You're not going to buy another pack."
Right.
Almost every smoker has done that.
Sure.
That unconscious was there going, when you start running down, you go to the store and you purchase it. That's the programming in there.
Yeah, you can't run out.
So changing the programming in the other than conscious mind or the unconscious, now when the conscious says, you're not smoking anymore, that's your last cigarette, the unconscious agrees, as opposed to before, you have that conscious mind saying, that's your last cigarette, no more. The unconscious goes, you're going to the store and you're doing it now.
No matter what time of the night it is.
How many times have you been to the refrigerator, opened it up, and then went, why am I in the refrigerator? I don't even remember opening it.
Right.
We've all done this.
And I can't figure out why I don't know what was in there because I looked an hour ago.
Exactly. And 5 minutes later, you're back at the refrigerator with it open again. That is the programming in the unconscious. When the programming, using neuro-linguistic programming or hypnotherapy, which go hand in hand,
right,
makes the changes in the unconscious so that it matches what the conscious is trying to achieve. Then, as opposed to having, think of it this way, if you have the bouncer with you, this big guy,
right,
and you're saying, I'm going over here, and the bouncer says, oh no, you're not, he's gonna move you and put you where he wants you, right?
Certainly.
However, if the bouncer's on the same page with you, and you say, I'm going over here, and he goes, yep, let's go, you're getting in.
Sure.
That bouncer's your unconscious.
Right.
You need that unconscious on the same page in agreement. And that's where the NLP techniques and the hypnotherapy techniques.
So this is the old cartoon where I've got the angel on one shoulder and the devil on the other.
We all have parts.
Right.
And those parts all have a positive intention. They want to do something good for you, even if it's smoking.
Mm-hmm.
It's doing it for a good reason. Maybe it's the only time you take a break.
Right.
Or maybe it's the only time you take a deep breath, or any of a number of other things.
Certainly.
When that part, and we've all done this, we'll say, part of me wants to lose weight, but there's this other part that really wants that piece of cake.
Well, yeah, and it's also a a timing thing. I get that piece of cake now. If I want to lose weight, it's going to be many not having pieces of cake over a long period of time.
Yes, and that's one of the things. It never is a thing of never.
Right.
Never, never. You don't want to be saying, I can never have that piece of cake.
Right.
If you do, you're going to land up craving the piece of cake because your unconscious still wants it, and all you're doing is focusing on cake.
It's the old, don't think about a pink elephant.
Exactly. You automatically will think about it. You can't even process the sentence without thinking about a pink elephant.
Correct. So, well, as I used to say on Car Talk, we have whiled away another hour here at KUPR. You are probably much more qualified to do this than myself because this is a 100-hour lecture series and we've done it in an hour. Can you kind of summarize what we've learned today and maybe give people some ideas of how to find out, where to find out more?
Sure. To summarize, really what we're talking about is exactly what we just said. Really, that the unconscious is what's controlling. That's the driver. By creating these changes through guided imagery, through specific exercises meant to change that internal coding. If the internal coding is different, then the outcome is different. A lot of it was based on computer science. You know, garbage in, garbage out.
Right.
If your coding in a computer, if code is written and you have bad code, you get a bad outcome. We want to change that coding that you have in your unconscious to produce the outcome you want when you run that program. That's the clearest way of describing it, if that makes sense. Insofar as being able to learn more, there's a lot of information out there. Obviously, anybody is more than welcome to contact me.
StanAlexander.com.
You know, any of your listeners, obviously, I would be more than happy to set up a free initial consultation for.
Well, that's very kind of you.
And,
I mean, all of us have at least one thing we want to work on.
Sure.
What's one or two things we can do to change pretty much anything? Just become aware of it?
Becoming aware of it's the first thing. If you're not aware of it, if you don't know something is broken, how do you fix it?
Yeah, but we all know that if we have bad behavior, eating, smoking, drinking, so we're aware of it, but maybe we're not aware of it in the right way?
Well, no, the first step is being just aware of it.
Okay, it's there.
Just that simple.
All right.
The second step really is either seeking out a professional to work with or doing enough of the homework on your own and saying, let me learn those technologies that I can attempt to apply them to myself. It's easier to apply them when a professional is guiding you through.
Certainly.
Which techniques are going to work best for you. There isn't, I mean, not to, this is no offense to your question at all, but it would be a lot like saying, what one tool can I use to build a house?
Checkbook.
That's about the only one. You know, there isn't one specific, a wrench isn't going to do it, a hammer isn't going to do it, a screwdriver isn't going to, a saw isn't going to, but all of the tools and knowing which tool to use at any given moment.
So even though I want to lose weight, it's not as simple as just eat less or don't. There are tools that people can help me with.
If you want to lose weight, I strongly recommend virtual gastric band.
Okay.
Virtual gastric band goes through four sessions, as well as homework of using an audio recording, as well as a list of eight guidelines.
Is that for people who are 100 pounds overweight or just even 20 pounds overweight?
It could be 10, 20 pounds. I've worked with people that have been several hundred pounds. In clinical trials, 24 out of 25 people were successful. This was originally developed in England.
Right.
And in there, first, yes, we do that visualization. We were talking about propulsion system before.
Right.
And I know we're going probably longer than...
Well, I know you have an appointment.
That's okay. We're fine. Let's forget virtual gastric band. We do a propulsion system.
Right.
One of the things, and I probably shouldn't tip too much of this in case anybody wants to do it, because I don't want to dilute the outcome.
Right.
But one thing is that person imagining what could happen if they don't. What are those issues that could come up? Now the person then being able to see what, and being able to think for themselves, what's your number one reason for for wanting to lose the weight, then being able to see that outcome, then going through imagining. Most people experience the surgery to the point they can smell the anesthetic in the room, or they can smell that hospital smell.
Right.
All aware of, but I'm not quite sure what that is.
Yeah.
I'm not quite sure.
I don't know if I want to know.
I don't probably want to know either. No, I think we'll pass on that one.
Yeah.
We'll go into another session where we want them to release all of those things that may have them holding on to the weight.
Right.
Because that might be part of the issue.
Sure.
We'll go through other parts of it to get a person to eat slower. We'll go through another part so an individual is going to stick to 3 small meals a day. Without fighting
right.
to do that. We'll go through another part that they start respecting their body, that they're not using it as a trash can.
Okay, oh, that's a good
one.
Because
if you think about it, when you're taking excess food that you no longer need and consuming it, you're using your body to throw the garbage out by throwing it into you.
And it's probably bad food choices anyway.
Probably. So we use all of these different types of techniques. In some ways, it becomes almost a shotgun.
Right.
Of which one does that person need? But that initial interview, I want to find out, what do you need? Why do you want this? If one of my first questions is on a scale of 0 to 10, let's say smoking or overeating.
Right.
On a scale of 0 to 10, 0 being, forget it, let's go over to Sonic. This is Sonic right next to my office.
Right. Dollar chili dogs today.
I wouldn't know. I haven't been there in a couple years. So if 0 is, let's go to Sonic.
Okay.
And 10 is, I'm willing to go through actual bariatric surgery to get this weight off and then have somebody over me 24/7 to enforce the behaviors.
Wow. That's...
Where do you fall on that scale? If a person... And I probably shouldn't tell people this. But if a person says 5, you know what that says to me?
No.
That says to me, I can take it or leave it. I really don't care. If a person says 2, I'll ask them, what are your main reasons? If it's, well, my doctor said I have to. My wife keeps nagging me about my smoking. Those are not good enough reasons. Like you said, it has to be, you know, about you.
Right. You have to want it.
You have to want it. Exactly.
You don't go through grad school because someone wants you to.
No. I would hope not.
No. I mean, you can say, oh, I'm doing it for Mom, but you're still doing it for you because it's way too hard.
You're still doing it for you.
Right.
So we're looking at using all of those types of techniques then, as well as then having the person going through a self-hypnosis audio on a daily basis for at least a month.
Right.
To reinforce those suggestions to the unconscious. So now that bouncer
right.
is going along with you and saying, you're done eating for now.
Put your knife and fork down.
Put your knife and fork down between each bite.
Between each bite? Good technique.
As opposed to...
Oh, sure.
We shovel in our society.
It's...
As opposed to saying, put it down, enjoy your food. Enjoy that person you're talking to.
But I'm starving. I gotta eat.
Most of it. Okay, how many of us have been starving in our lifetime?
Never.
There are some.
Really?
There are some.
Oh, yes, yes. Unfortunately.
But unfortunately, there are. I can honestly say I have never been starving in my lifetime. Thank God I've never have been starving in my lifetime. But we constantly will go, oh, I'm so hungry, I'm starving. No, you're not.
Yeah.
No, you're not.
Right.
You might want some food.
Right. And you might have a little low blood sugar or something.
So with virtual gastric band, we're using all of these techniques over a series of 4 sessions. With the intent, and many people need some follow-up afterwards.
Right.
But with the intent of, let's hit all of these different techniques. Let's throw in everything, including the kitchen sink, to try to make those unconscious changes. So that bouncer is now your ally, not your adversary. That's how I would sum it up.
That makes sense. I'm happier now.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. See, it worked.
Yes.
That's because of all of the linguistic things I was throwing in that you didn't know.
I didn't know.
I'm just kidding.
So, well, this has been what I consider a very interesting conversation with Stan Alexander here on Conversations with Matthew Bronson on ABQ Live TV and KEB. I'm going to have to edit the whole thing. This has been a very interesting conversation for myself with Stan Alexander. He is a neuro-linguistic programming practitioner, hypnotherapist, all-around cool guy here in the Albuquerque area. So for KUPR 99.9 FM in the high desert of Placitas and online the video at abqlive.tv, thank you very much, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you, Stan. Thank you, Matthew.